Hello everyone, in this video we'll talk about the hydrometer analysis. For more such videos and solved examples, you can sign up on our website. The link is given in the description. So last time we talked about the pipette method for doing the sedimentation analysis, and we use this sedimentation analysis or sedimentation method for the particle size analysis for fine grained soils. So there are two ways, as you understood. One is pipette method and the second one is hydrometer method. So in the previous video we covered the pipette method, and here we'll talk about the hydrometer method. So as we understood in this sedimentation analysis, that if we have these particles or fine grained soils in suspension, initially we shake this container properly so that the concentration of particles is uniform, and as the time passes, so these particles will settle, and their settling velocity depends on the particle size, that is, it is square of the dia of the particle. So the particles that are of larger size will settle quicker than the particles of smaller size. Now in pipette method, we take a sample from this constant depth. After, as the time passes, at time t1, t2, t3, and we dry this sample and find out the weight of the particle, and then we divide it by the weight of the particle in the original suspension, and that way we find out the percentage finer. Now in this case, for doing this calculation of percentage finer, instead of using a pipette, we are using something called a hydrometer. So hydrometer looks something like this. You can look up on internet also for actual images. So it has a bulb at this bottom, and then there is a long tube attached to it, and there we have these readings. Now with the help of hydrometer, we can indirectly correlate this readings of the hydrometer to the specific gravity of the suspension. And with the help of this specific gravity of the suspension, we can find out this percentage finer than the particle size. How do we do that? So basically, as we put the hydrometer, so its weight is balanced by the buoyancy force from this suspension. Its weight, let's say, is W. So it is balanced by the buoyancy force. Now this buoyant force depends on the unit weight of the suspension, that is, let's say gamma suspension is the unit weight of the suspension. So this buoyant force is a function of this unit weight, or we can also say the specific gravity. Now as the time passes, we know as the time passes these particles settle. Initially in this case also we shake this container, so the particles at all the levels are in uniform concentration. So as the time passes, these particles keep settling, and because of that, at different levels in this container, the specific gravity or unit weight unit weight or specific gravity is different at different levels. And obviously, as the particles are settling down, so in this part only water will be present in the top layers, so the unit weight or the specific gravity will be reducing. This at different level, the specific gravity or unit weight is different, and it is less at the top levels or top layers, we can say. So for the same weight of the hydrometer, for this weight to be balanced, it will be sinking more and more. More of this fluid or suspension will be required to develop the same buoyant force, because at the top layers, the value of this unit weight will be reducing. We write the buoyant force as the volume of the fluid displaced. So volume that will be displaced, it will be equal to the volume of hydrometer times the unit weight of the fluid, or here we can say unit weight of the suspension. So this will be the buoyant force, and this buoyant force has to balance the weight of the hydrometer. Now, because this gamma value is reducing, so for developing the same buoyant force, the hydrometer will be displacing more volume. Now, as the unit weight of the suspension is smaller at top levels, so it will be sinking more and more to develop the same buoyant force. And then here we can read these readings on the scale, and that gives us the indirect value of the specific gravity. So it is correlated in such a way that if the reading that we are reading from here is RC, then 1 plus RC by 100 gives the specific gravity of the soil suspension. So the basic idea here also, it is same, that we are trying to do what we did in the pipette method also. That is, if we are measuring, if we are taking the measurement at this level, then above this level, all the particles that are present will be smaller than a particular size d, and that will depend on the velocity of settlement that we find out using Stokes' law, g by 18 gs minus 1 d square upon nu. So above a particular level where we are taking the reading, only the particles of dia smaller than this d will be present. Now, how do we correlate the two? That's what we'll understand here. So the basic equation, that is the percentage of particles finer than d, it is given as how we wrote in the pipette method also, weight of solids per cc at a depth he after time t. He is the depth at which we make the observations in this method, which we call as the effective depth, and divided by the weight of solids per cc in the original suspension times 100, that we are, because we are calculating in percentage. Now let's say weight of solids per cc at a depth he, we are denoting with WD, and weight of solids in the original suspension we are denoting with capital W. So this is how the formula looks like for the particles finer than, for the percentage of particles finer than a specific dia d. Now, as I said, if we are measuring the hydrometer reading RC from, I mean, when we do the observation here, so if we are measuring RC, then 1 plus RC by 100, it gives the specific gravity of soil suspension. So this specific gravity of soil suspension, we can write it as weight of water per cc plus immersed weight of solids per cc divided by the weight of water per cc. That is just breaking down the formula of specific gravity. So in the top, we are taking the weight of the suspension, which is including the particles also, and in the denominator part, we are taking the weight of the water alone in the same volume. So here we are doing per cc calculation to ensure the same volume. So weight of water per cc is nothing but the unit weight of water. Immersed weight of solids, we can write as, immersed weight is nothing but the submerged weight. So that we can write as gamma s minus gamma w, unit weight times weight of solids. If we do this, then we get the weight of, or we can say submerged weight of solids, w dash, we can say submerged weight of solids. It is similar to how we write for submerged unit weight. There also we do the gamma t, or whatever is the unit weight, gamma saturated minus gamma w. So instead of this gamma saturated what we use for soil, here we are doing for solids. So it is gamma s for solids minus unit weight of water times Vs divided by the total volume. So total volume will be the volume of solids plus volume of water. This calculation we are doing in this for this container, which is containing the water as well as the solids. And so this is the numerator term here and divided by the weight of water per cc, that is unit weight of water. Then we can write this term as gamma W plus, if we take Vs gamma S common here, so it will become Vs gamma S upon Vs plus Vw times 1 minus gamma W upon gamma S divided by gamma W. Then this term here, Vs gamma W upon Vs plus Vw, if you see, what is this term denoting? So Vs is the volume of solids and gamma S is the unit weight of solids. So volume times unit weight, it gives us the weight. So unit weight of solids times volume of solids is the weight of solids. So this term is weight of solids divided by total volume. So if you see in this definition here, so here we are trying to find out the weight of solids per cc at a given depth. So at a given depth, if we measure this term, so this is nothing but the weight of solids per cc, because we are dividing it with volume at a given depth. So this we denote with WD. So this here is the numerator term of this final equation that we are interested in, that is WD. So we can replace it with, we can write it as 1 plus WD by gamma W, 1 minus, and this is gamma S upon gamma W. If we take this gamma W in the denominator, and that is nothing but the specific gravity of solids. So that's how we find it. And on this side, we have 1 plus RC upon 100. This RC is the hydrometer reading. So this cancels out. And from here, we find out WD as RC gamma W. This here is 1000, not 100. Here also it says 1000. So RC gamma W divided by 1000, 1 minus 1 upon GS. That way we can find out the weight of solids per cc at a given depth HE. And we have to divide this WD by initial concentration. So for initial concentration, we can take the hydrometer reading when we start the experiment. So that will give us the initial concentration, and after some time passes, then we can find out with the other reading. Now we have to also find out what is this depth HE at which we take the observations. So for measuring this effective depth, we have some more terms involved here, that is small h. Small h is the height of the hydrometer bulb, and h1 is the height from this neck up to the point where we are measuring this reading. And he, that is the effective depth, we take from the point we are taking the reading up to the mid of this hydrometer bulb. Why we are doing that? So for a hydrometer, it is designed in such a way that the specific gravity or the reading that we measure from this scale, it gives the value of specific gravity at the mid height of the hydrometer. So we have to establish a relation for this HE here. Why is that? Because when we insert the hydrometer in the suspension, then let's say we want to measure the reading at this level BB, but when we insert this hydrometer, this level BB will rise to another level, that is B1. And similarly, the top of this suspension level or top of the water level in this hydrometer, it will rise to A1. So we have to establish a relation in such a way that we can find out this height here. This height is nothing but the value HE, because this is what it would have looked like if the rise in the water level had not taken place. So let's say if VH is the volume of the hydrometer, then what will be the rise in water level because of this volume? So VH divided by cross-sectional area of the jar, it will be the rise in water level because of the insertion of this hydrometer. So for measuring this height here, HE, between A and between B1, I mean between the layer AA and between the layer B1, B1, we can write HE. And so this VH upon AJ is the rise in the water level. So this initially this layer was at this red level and it went to this level A1, A1. So this value is equal to VH upon AJ. And because the hydrometer measures the reading at this mid depth, so we can say only half of the volume of this hydrometer will be present below this depth. So here the rise in level, we can write it will be half of this value, and that is equal to VH upon 2AJ. Now for measuring the value of HE from all these observations that we have made in the term of H, H1 and VH upon AJ, we can write HE as, first we'll calculate the total depth up from starting from BB up to level A1, A1, and then we'll deduct this part from the depth. So we can write HE is equal to H1 plus H by 2. So H1 here is the depth from the reading level up to hydrometer neck. So this is H1 plus up to this mid level, that is small h by 2, plus below this level we have this term VH upon 2J. So plus VH upon 2AJ. AJ is the area of jar. So that gives us the complete depth. This is VH upon 2AJ. Now we'll deduct this part of the depth from it to obtain the value of HE, and this part of the depth is nothing but VH upon AJ. So minus VH upon AJ, this will give us the effective depth. So if we rearrange these terms here, we obtain HE is equal to H1 plus 1 by 2 H minus VH upon AJ. So that way the value of this effective depth is calculated. Now if we talk about how we perform this test, so I'll only discuss a few points that are the major point. So first of all, we take a 50 gram oven dried sample, and that is passed from 75 micron sieve, and then in this sample we add the deflocculating agent, and apart from that we'll also add the water, and after resting it for a few minutes we take this sample into this measuring container and we'll fill up more water so that the total volume of this suspension is 1000 ml. Then by covering the top layer of this container and shaking it well, we mix all the particles that are present and to make the sample homogeneous. And then we start using our hydrometer for taking the readings. So these readings are taken at various time intervals, starting from 20 seconds to up to about 4 hours. So for each reading, as the time passes, this hydrometer will be inserted in the samples, and we'll wait for 30 seconds so that whatever are the undulations, those become normal and we can take a steady reading. Then we take out the hydrometer, and after some time again we'll follow the same procedure to take the reading. So as the time passes, the hydrometer will settle more and more into the sample. Now there is one more thing left, that is the corrections to hydrometer reading. So this value here that we use RC as the hydrometer reading, we have to correct this reading before we use it in the equation 1 plus RC by 1000. So for this correction, we have three types of correction here. First one is meniscus correction, second one is temperature correction, and the third one is deflocculating agent correction. So meniscus correction, it is always positive. Temperature correction can be positive or negative, and deflocculating agent is always negative. So what are these corrections? Now we know, as we insert this hydrometer, so at the level of this hydrometer, a meniscus will form. This type of meniscus will form in the water. So basically we should be taking the reading as the at the bottom of this meniscus, but because of the turbidity in the suspension, this level is not visible to us. So we take the top layer here as the actual reading, and the value of these readings, if we talk about the graduations, so they increase in the downward direction, that is 5, 10, 15, 20, it is increasing in the downward direction. So we can say that the actual reading, if we take at the bottom of the meniscus, it will be a higher value because it is at the bottom side, but we are measuring at the top part. So this correction is additive. Whatever is the meniscus correction, it has to be added to this value. Then the next one is temperature correction. So we know the specific gravity, it depends on the temperature also. So this standard value, it is given for 27 degrees Celsius. But if the temperature is higher or lower than this, then there will be a change in the value of this reading, because the specific gravity of suspension will be different. And we know if the temperature is higher, then the specific gravity reduces. So if the temperature is higher than 27 degrees Celsius, then specific gravity will be less and the hydrometer will sink more. So if it will sink more, then it will give a smaller value, but the actual value that should come at 27 degrees Celsius should be higher. So if the temperature is higher than this value, then we have a positive correction, and the same logic we can apply in the opposite direction also. That is, if the temperature is lower than this value, then the specific gravity of the suspension will be higher, and in that case the reading what we'll get, it will be on the higher side. The actual value should be somewhere here, but because it will not submerge as much as it should be, this value here, it will be corresponding to 27 degrees Celsius, and this value will be at a temperature less than 27. So this value we have to deduct. So in that case, that correction will be of negative type. Then we have deflocculating agent correction. So deflocculating agent we add into this suspension, and that increases the specific gravity. Then what will be the specific gravity of water alone? And for that reason, if the specific gravity is higher, then it will not submerge as much as it will submerge if only water is present. That is, if only water is present, then it will go up to some this level, let's say. But if deflocculating agent is also present, so specific gravity will increase, and that will increase the unit weight, and because of that it will go only up to some this level. So because of that, we have to deduct for this deflocculating agent correction, similar to how we obtain this negative correction in the case of temperature. So these are the three corrections for hydrometer. If you found this video useful, please like, subscribe, and share this video with your friends.